So this is May, and it's part of May Works, which is something sponsored by Washington State Labor Council and trying to bring together labor and civil rights framework. And we just had May Day, and I'm going to talk a little bit about that, but we want to start with a song, right? So this is a song from the South. Most of the freedom songs start with a spiritual, and this was Ain't No Harm to Keep Your Mind Stayed, keeping it in one place. Stayed on freedom, but originally it was Stayed on Jesus. You just change one word and now it's gone from a religious song to a spiritual. And it was one of the songs used a lot in the Memphis sanitation strike. The second part of the song is something that Ralph Chaplin wrote in 1917, but it was originally a freedom song also. Julia Ward Howe wrote it, and it was also sung as John Brown's Body, and it was also sung as We're the Bully Soldiers of the First of Arkansas. We're fighting for the Union. We're fighting for the law. We can hit a rebel further than a white man ever saw. There's a whole program that we've done together called Links on the Chain. This is just one of those songs. I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on freedom. I woke up this morning with my mind stayed on freedom. Woke up this morning with my mind it was stayed on freedom. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. You know I'm walking and talking with my mind it was stayed on freedom.
When the Union's inspiration
So it's important in my world to connect the labor and the civil rights issues. I grew up at a time when they were very much connected, and also worked in the South after Dr. King was killed. And so let me tell you about this book, and I'll try to be sort of economical about it. It came out of a lot of work that I've done over about 30 years, and somewhere in here there's some list of some of the works I did. But essentially, you know, what kind of book is it? What's it for? And it's not a biography. There's a lot of great biographies of King already written, and I wouldn't try to write anything better than what people have written already. And it's not a narrative history, like this happened and that happened, and so forth. That's why it's a skinny book. It's only 200 pages. So some of you know I've written some fat books in the past. The Going Down Jericho Road book was a big fat book. And that was the definitive story, really, of the Memphis strike and King's participation in it. So I also did a book of King's labor speeches called All Labor Has Dignity, which has proven to be pretty powerful and popular. I was surprised. I got a call from Sherrod Brown, the U.S. Senator from Ohio, and Kamala Harris, the U.S. Senator from California, and he were talking about King and labor. And he said, I wish there was something on King and labor, and she gave him my book. And he bought 40 copies of it and distributed it in Congress. And so we're trying to get them to distribute this one, too. So anyway, he called me up and told me all this. And I was like, oh my God. So I think that, you know, there was an early version of King, which is King is a civil rights leader, and I have a dream, and that was sort of the end of the story. And then we went through a phase of saying, yeah, but he became more radical after 65 and to 68. So that part of the story usually didn't get told. So one of the reasons I wrote the book on Memphis, the Memphis sanitation strike, Going Down Jericho Road, is because that movement was just as important as the Montgomery bus boycott. And they're sort of bookends on King's life. You know, one is this tremendous community movement for 381 days in Montgomery, and the other one is 1,300 men on strike for 2 months in Memphis. And so most of the biographies of King take you up till Memphis, and then, like David Garrow's Pulitzer Prize-winning book, the last three pages are about Memphis. So it doesn't really explain to you the significance of that moment. And most of the biographies are like that. So my Going Down Jericho Road was an antidote to that. And so people, we've made some headway. People, since that book came out and the Book of King's speeches, have started to see King as not only a civil rights leader, but as a labor hero, as somebody who was concerned about war and peace and social justice and economic justice all the way around. And so, you know, years ago, you'd go to the King holiday events in January, and you'd just hear, I have a dream, I have a dream. Now it's starting to filter in. I've been to the mountaintop, and I've seen the promised land, and I may not get there with you, but we as a people will get to the promised land. So then my question is, well, what was the promised land to King? And so that's what this book is really about. It's not a biography, it's not a narrative history. It's trying to sort of reframe King so that people can better understand the significance of not just him, but of the movement that he led. And I'm not somebody who, you know, is a hero worshiper of or a great man theory of history. I don't think that way. I think more like Ella Baker, that you know, we need group-centered leadership, not a leadership-centered group. But I've also come to think, after studying King for a long time, that we needed everybody. We need different kinds of things. So a lot of our scholarship on the civil rights movement tends to bifurcate a problem, which is King and the leadership and the grassroots down here is the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and they're like kind of in conflict, and they were kind of in conflict. But I think it's time to sort of readjust our thinking about the role that different people play in movements for social change. And his role was extraordinary, and not too many people could do what he did. That's not to say that it's the great man theory of history. He said in Montgomery bus boycott, he said, if I wasn't here, this movement would have happened anyway. It just happens that I'm here. And so I'm your servant. I'm trying to, you know, speak the issues. And the thing about King that's so marvelous is that by studying that history and the movements that he was part of and the things that he had to say, it really illuminates a lot of the issues in our whole history. And so I'm just going to kind of work through the book real quickly. But I want to start with a quote at the way the book starts. Each chapter has a quote, and each chapter is based on the quote. And at the beginning, to make the point that King didn't become just radical after 1965 when the Vietnam War escalated and then he became a radical. This is him speaking to Highlander Folk School in 1957, 1 year after the Montgomery bus boycott. I never intend to adjust myself to the tragic inequalities of an economic system which takes necessities from the masses to give luxuries to the classes. I never intend to become adjusted to the madness of militarism and the self-defeating method of physical violence. I call on you to be maladjusted. And so that should be a slogan for us today, right? Be maladjusted. And here's another quote from him a couple years later. He's speaking to the AFL-CIO, and he's talking about the right-wing coalition that's forming, even in as early as 1961. And of course, really, it's not early, because remember, we had the McCarthy era in the 50s. And so a lot of the movement coming out of the 50s and 60s was struggling against that whole kind of mindless, paranoid anti-communism. So he said, whether it's the ultra-right wing in the form of the Birch Societies, funded by the Koch brothers, or the alliance, which former President Eisenhower denounced, the alliance between big military and big business, $600 billion military bill, or the coalition of Southern Dixiecrats and Northern reactionaries, now it's all Southern Republicans. Whatever the form, these menaces now threaten everything decent and fair in American life. And he was talking about something he was seeing in the far distance. This is before the civil rights victories, before the Voting Rights Act. But he's seeing this momentum build up on the right that's going to resist the civil rights movement and the labor movement. But he always has hope. At times we confront difficult and frustrating moments, could be this one, in the struggle to make justice a reality, but we must believe somehow these problems can be solved. And so the book is set up that way, which is not to make people feel hopeless, but rather to help infuse a level of analysis and understanding that people had, not only King, but the labor movement, civil rights movement, the women's movement, the anti-war movement, the student movement. There was a tremendous coalition that was building in the 60s that King saw as, you know, the opportunity to have a majority coalition take power. And of course, we know some very tragic things sort of cut that off so that it didn't happen. So when I'm talking around the country, I was in Memphis for 5 days around April 4th, which was 50 years since King was killed. People came from all over. It was like a pilgrimage to Memphis. People just wanted to be there. And the question then was, okay, we're remembering King, but how do we remember King? And so we had 3 days of just discussions and debates, and a lot of the great people were there. And Jesse Jackson was particularly amazing. He spoke from the balcony where King was shot. And he was there when that happened. And I was looking across from him, hearing him speak at the Lorraine Motel, which is now the National Civil Rights Museum. And Jesse Jackson, at the last night of these series of gatherings we had, said that in every case where we made a big breakthrough, there was a campaign in a particular place around a particular issue. So racism in transportation, the Montgomery bus boycott, the Freedom Rides, other campaigns in the South, public accommodations, the Birmingham movement, voting rights, Selma, open housing, Chicago. I mean, this is how they worked. 1968 Memphis, economic justice. That's what it was about. And labor rights, that's what it was about. So when people talk about it, you know, they have to understand he died in a union struggle. What does that mean? You know, that a civil rights leader dies in a union struggle. And he also called for a general strike in Memphis of everybody who was sympathetic to the sanitation workers. That would have been the high point of the civil rights movement of the 60s, to actually have a general strike. It never happened around a civil rights issue. So Jesse Jackson said, we did all that, so why don't we make a campaign based in Memphis around poverty? Memphis is now the poorest city of its size in the country. More than half of the kids grow up in poverty in Memphis. Certain neighborhoods like Orange Mound in South Memphis is still humongous unemployment, you know, tremendous poverty rates in that area. And yet, you can also see in Memphis really wealthy people and, you know, the rich and the poor. But Jesse Jackson said, let's make Memphis the campaign to end poverty. But of course, he's just saying, you know, we need a focal point. And Reverend Barber and Liz Theo Harris are now doing the Poor People's Campaign, trying to get people to remember that moment, which was King's effort to make poverty the issue. So let me just flip through these slides a little bit. So what we're trying to do here, there we go. We have a new generation of scholarship about civil rights and links labor and civil rights and has an economic view, but most people don't know that literature. So this book is an attempt to bring it to people. And W.W. Norton, the publisher, really pushed me to get it done in order to come out for April 4th of this year. And the idea is to get people to get the full message, to get beyond the iconic view of King as an advocate for racial harmony, which he was, but to also explore his commitment to the poor and working class and call for nonviolent resistance to all forms of oppression. And what he called as seeking a moral revolution. And I remember at the time, I was like, you know, a teenager and following King very closely. And when he said, we need a moral revolution, I said, no, we need a real revolution. Like, we need to overthrow the state. And so, like a good friend of mine, Claiborne Carson, who's the editor of the King Papers, says, as I get older, King becomes more wise every day. What King was saying is that in order to get the structure to change, you have to change the way people are thinking. And that's what he was so good at doing, and a powerful advocate for that. So the idea here is to think about the promised land in our time. And Robin Kelly, this great writer, called it a dangerous book, which I don't know if that's possible, but Communism Manifesto is a lot more dangerous, I'm sure. But anyway, it's a nice quote. So one of the things in doing the book that I wanted to point out was that King's roots are in slavery, that his great-grandparents were slaves. His grandfather was a sharecropper. His father was a sharecropper. He came out of poverty, but grew up in the black middle class in the middle of the Great Depression. He was born in 1929. But this quote from, what do we got here, 1967 in Chicago, it's during the beginning of the Poor People's Campaign. He talks about his family and slavery. When he goes down into the South to organize the Poor People's Campaign, I've got the speeches from that tour, and he's talking about slavery all the time. And this is one of the things, you know, Americans don't get. Like James Baldwin said, all white Americans always have to be innocent. Like, this happened, but it wasn't me that did it, so I'm innocent. And he says, but you can't be innocent if you don't pay attention and know about what happened. That's not innocence. You know, that's going along with what happened. So part of the thing in the book is trying to draw that out, that King talked about 1963, the March on Washington, was to have a second emancipation. 100 years before was the Emancipation Proclamation, Reconstruction, and then voting rights, and then it all got overturned through the Ku Klux Klan and racial repression. So one of the things in the book is to look at the whole picture, even though it's a short book. And another important part that pops up in the book a lot is about women. women. So we know about Rosa Parks, but there's now a great book by Theo Harris about the rebellious life of Rosa Parks. And she traces her back to the 1930s and 40s when she was working on the Scottsboro case, a frame-up of young men, racial frame-up, the rape of black women by white men. Oprah Winfrey brought it up at the Oscars. This came from this book called At the Dark End of the Street. So the women were key to that bus boycott, and they were also key to the Memphis sanitation strike. You wouldn't think that. You think there's 1,300 men, I am a man slogan, but it was the women that were organizing the economic boycott of the downtown. It was the women that were raising food and money for the strike. It was the women that were keeping the families together that made it possible for these men to go out every day on the picket line. So this is something that we want to foreground in order to get a really full picture of the movement. And of course, King himself, as soon as this movement started, was constantly threatened. His life was constantly threatened. This is one of the arrests. And then, of course, they won. And so what we want to point out is the role of Coretta Scott King. There's a new book. She wrote one autobiography, and then a second autobiography came out after she died, which is more interesting in a lot of ways. And her family was from Deep South Alabama. Her father ran a lumber mill. Whites burned it down. Her uncle was lynched, shot and lynched. Her father carried a pistol in his open glove compartment every day. She came from a really hard life, much harder than King, than her husband did. And she was in the Progressive Party convention in 1948, which was red-baited all over the place. And she was a peace supporter of, you know, way back. And a lot of Martin's development really was based on being married to this person, and vice versa. You know, they worked together very much as a team. So this is part of the problem that occurred at the time. This is Martin Luther King at Highlander Folk School, and Rosa Parks, and she went to Highlander 2 weeks before she refused to give up her seat on the bus. She went to a protest meeting about the murder of Emmett Till 4 days before she refused to get up from her seat on the bus. And this is David Abernathy, and this is Cherise Horton, Miles Horton's daughter, and this is Pete Seeger, our beloved singer. And they had a great meeting in 1957 at Highlander, and it was when King was just first becoming known. It was like right after the Montgomery bus boycott. And this is how it was interpreted to the South. Martin Luther King at a communist training school. And I actually have this photo on a postcard from the John Birch Society. I don't know how I got it. I'm sure they didn't mail it to me, but I got it somewhere. People saw this marching from Montgomery, from Selma to Montgomery. There's a picture of King marching by this. I couldn't find that photo, but I've seen it. And So this is the way people were indoctrinated to see that, you know, who became the most famous Baptist preacher in the world was actually a communist. And the Koch brothers and people like that were very active in all of this. Nancy MacLean has a new book called Democracy in Chains, where she explains how this whole mythology got perpetuated. Of course, one of the things about King that people don't really understand usually is about nonviolence, and that's a crucial issue. I made a film some of you saw about James Lawson, who was right-hand man to King, called Love and Solidarity. And he told me, Americans don't fully understand King because they don't understand nonviolence. An advocate of nonviolence has made a major decision and a major analysis that is all-encompassing. Life's cruelty systems are interrelated parts of the same problem. So if you're a nonviolence advocate, you're automatically, quote, a radical, because you're looking at capitalism, imperialism, militarism, racism, sexism, all the isms that, you know, you can put together in one basket, and you're trying to change the whole structure, the whole framework of all of that. I was at the King Center after Memphis on April 5th, and this is what they have outside of the King Center for nonviolence, is trying to teach people the principles of nonviolence. And that's really one of the ways we should remember King, is to really learn from those principles. James Lawson came to our campus at UW-Tacoma, and we're trying to make a book of his writings and speeches. And he told our students, he said, you know, when I talk about nonviolence, Americans look at me like I'm speaking a foreign language. They don't know what, they have no idea. Nonviolence? You know, what is that? You know, it just so goes against the way that people in power today are working. And people can hardly comprehend it. So I'll move a little faster. One of the important things is to understand that the civil rights movement was very much a working class movement. These are people in Detroit. The March on Detroit was 125,000 people before the March on Washington was 250,000 people. And it was all organized by unions and civil rights people in Detroit. And King had these kind of audiences everywhere he went. He was very much tuned in to working class people throughout his career. And the United Farm Workers movement was starting right around that same time. This is the Birmingham campaign, which, you know, nonviolence is a strategy. It's a pragmatic strategy about how to win battles by sort of helping people to see what's right and what's wrong. And that's what they did through these demonstrations. And King's famous letter from Birmingham jail. But some of the lesser known things are like, this is after he came back from getting the Nobel Peace Prize, and he went on a picket line with 800 black women in Atlanta at the Scripto factory, and they won the strike largely because of the civil rights movement intervening. Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, King worked through the South in different places. Of course, Selma, this is John Lewis being beaten, getting the Voting Rights Act in 1965. And this resonated all over the country. This is in Harlem, but there were demonstrations everywhere in support of the Selma movement. And again, the role of women, you know, very often the rank and file in these things are women. And Dave, I think, let's see, we're ready to go. Actually, let's see if you can do it. Go down to the bottom. Oh, there we go. Wait a minute, let me jump through a little bit. It turned itself off. So these are some pictures of King down in the Deep South leading up to the Poor People's Campaign and the Memphis Campaign. And of course, one of the key things that happened was the rebellions in the cities. This is Detroit, where my family is from, in the summer of 1967. A horrible conflagration, 43 people killed. Dozens of these occurrences all over the country, and it sort of split, it polarized the public even more than it already was. And in 1966, we got a right-wing Congress, and it started becoming difficult to pass any kind of new laws. This is an interesting picture to me. King spoke in Detroit just a few days before he came to Memphis in March of 1967. He was attacked by a group called Breakthrough, which was a real extreme anti-communist group. Whenever we would have demonstrations in Michigan, they would come out and bust up our picket lines, and they're a very violent group, and they actually shut down his question and answer period. And then he went to Memphis a few days later, and of course that's a whole big story in itself, and I won't go into it because I'll let King explain it right here. This is March 18th, a speech that I title, All Labor Has Dignity. So let's see if we can hear something from Dr. King.
Oh, freedom. Oh, freedom. And before I'd be a slave, I'd be buried in my grave. But I will rise for my right to be free.
If we are going to get equality, if we are going to get adequate wages, we are going to have to struggle for it. Now, you know what? You may have to escalate the struggle a bit. If they keep refusing and they will not recognize the union and will not agree for the checkoff of the collection of dues, I tell you what you ought to do, and you're together here enough to do it. In a few days, you ought to get together and just have a general work stoppage in the city of Memphis.
You know we're standing for our unions and we shall not be moved. You know we're standing for our unions and know that we shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the water. We shall not be moved. And that's why I say there ain't no harm to keep your mind stayed on freedom. There ain't no harm to keep your mind stayed on freedom. There ain't no harm to keep your mind stayed on freedom. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. You know how I walk and talk.
Okay, I'll just sort of pull it together here and then we're going to have some discussion. King's mission to Memphis was not about the strike. He was planning and organizing something called the Poor People's Campaign. And the strike came up, and Reverend Lawson was there in Memphis and called him and said, you've got to come, we really need some support. King had indicted the Vietnam War, April 4th, 1967, 1 year to the day before he was killed. And really, the strongest criticism of any mainstream leader at the time would be this speech that King made on April 4th, 1967. And he was starting to really say things that he'd been thinking and saying more in private all of his life, pretty much. speaking to his staff, he said, something is wrong with capitalism as it now stands in the U.S. We're not interested in being integrated into this value structure. A radical redistribution of power and values must take place. Our economy must become more person-centered than property-centered and profit-centered. Rather than integrating into existing values, as the early civil rights movement seemed to do, the movement needed to change the values themselves and change the structures of power. As Andrew Young, his aide, put it, even if you're a winner in a rat race, you're still a rat. So King had a very definite program around this. He wanted to spend $30 billion for 10 years. He wanted to build 500,000 units of new low-cost housing. Instead of just giving band-aids like welfare and food stamps, he called for a minimum standard of living. And he didn't mean minimum like poverty wage. He meant like that everybody, if the economy couldn't provide jobs for all the people, then there's so much wealth in the United States, then they should provide incomes, either jobs or incomes. And that's what the slogan of the Poor People's Campaign, jobs or incomes. And that way people could buy their own housing, they could pay for their own college education, they didn't have to go to the state to get the handout, they would have it already there. Some of the European countries have this already. It's not crazy thinking. And one way to think about it now is King was saying, this is the richest country in the world, so I don't understand why we can't eliminate poverty. And since his time, if we think about it, think about the $6 trillion spent since the Iraq War, what you could have done about poverty. And we say we can't afford it, but we could afford $6 trillion to do that. And King's whole point was that the priorities are wrong, that trillions of dollars have been spent on war, bank bailouts, tax cuts that it could have invested in schools, housing, healthcare, and jobs. And of course, you know, I'm speaking to the choir here, so to speak, in reality. But it's a message that, you know, we just have to keep saying it, that what's going on now is really crazy. It doesn't make any sense. And one way to do it is telling the story through, once a year, people get together for the King holiday. And I remember when we were marching to try to prevent the Iraq War through the streets of Seattle, and they were playing King's speech of April 4th, 1967, about the madness of militarism. And I particularly like this. This was 4 days after King was killed, and the next generation of people started picking it up. Ever since then, you know, most of us celebrate King on January 15th, but in Memphis, they always celebrate also. It's not celebrate, they commemorate April 4th. It's really had a huge effect on that city. And workers have made King into a labor hero as well. The Poor People's Campaign did continue. You know, we think of it as a failed effort, but this is the welfare rights organization that led the Mother's Day March on May 12th, 1968. A lot of unions were involved in that whole campaign. This was Memphis, again, with Reverend Lawson, starting to commemorate King every year on April 4th. And Coretta King went on to lead strikes. This is the 1199 hospital workers strike in Charleston, South Carolina, the next year. She also helped to support strikes in Memphis that occurred later on. She worked on the grape boycott very much. She worked with Dolores Huerta on the right from the United Farm Workers. And that was Cesar Chavez. Sorry, flipped over. And then I'll just finish with this. So, you know, the historians are not value-free. For me, this whole sort of struggle to tell the history of labor and civil rights comes out of my own experience to begin with. Growing up in a what at the time was a strong union state, Michigan, it's now a right-to-work state, which I can't believe. And this was an anti-war demonstration in Detroit, where I, in the area where I went to college. And of course, we're involved in SDS. That's that guy right there. And I went down south as a conscientious objector. I really followed King's teachings, you know, which he said everybody should become a conscientious objector, and I did. I said I wouldn't fight in the Vietnam War. And as soon as I got there, I ended up in jail. So this was the most, I won't go into the details of it because I don't want to take the time, but any time you protested for the right thing, you would end up in jail. And it was my best teaching experience, or learning experience, was being in a southern jail for 3 weeks. And then we worked on the Angela Davis case. I went to Memphis in the aftermath of King's death in 1970. Free Angela Davis. Interesting, this guy is a police informant. He was head of the Vietnam Veterans Against the War. And the man who took the picture also was a FBI informant who was a well-known photographer named Ernest Withers. So someday I'm going to write about that also. So these are some of the campaigns. This is the Wilmington 10 case in the 70s. My point, this is at the South African Embassy in DC, where I went to graduate school at Howard University. My point is that the movements didn't stop. You know, Jesse Jackson said at the balcony in Memphis, as soon as that shot rang out and King went down, we knew this was going to happen at some point. We talked about it a lot. And we just immediately went, okay, what's the next step? What are we doing now? And it was, of course, a horrible moment and really shocked people into, you know, failure in a lot of cases. But the point is that you keep moving, that it's a movement, and you may have some losses. So let's see, I think Davis thing just pooped out on me again. I just want to leave up the last slide. I don't know why it's doing that. There we go. So unions remember the April 4th. There were thousands of union members in Memphis on April 4th. The I Am a Man slogan became the slogan for everything last week. This is the Lorraine Motel, which is now the Civil Rights Museum. And this was Memphis on April 4th this year. And like I said, people just came from everywhere. It was a pilgrimage, but it was a labor-based pilgrimage. It was AFSCME that led this campaign. They called I Am 2018. And I Am 2018 is to get people mobilized based on the power of historical memory to keep going into new campaigns. And surprisingly, or I shouldn't be surprised, but who should I find there but Willie Adams from ILWU, Secretary Treasurer from Oakland, or from San Francisco, and the president of our local from Tacoma. We all ended up in the same march. This was on the sidewalk as we marched around. The struggle continues. And then I went on to Atlanta. And I'll end with that and ask Latasha Levy if she would come up and have some discussion. And so we've been thinking, like, I try to go about 35 or 40 minutes, and then we try to have like 15 or 20 minutes discussion, and then we'll end with some music.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for inviting me to be a part of the conversation. And I just have to tell you, I love, love, love this book. I am a student of the 60s. My degrees are in Black Studies, which was a result of the student movement in the 1960s. Every chance I get, I teach it, Civil Rights and Black Power era. Right. And my work actually tries to engage a rightward shift in Black Republican politics from Nixon to Reagan. Mm-hmm. And so I need prayer for that, Charles. I try to get through that project. But I just want to thank you, too, for your commitment to telling these alternative stories of the Civil Rights Movement. You really model the best of scholar activism, mm-hmm. and so I really appreciate the work that you've been doing. There's so many things that, you know, I can't tell you how much I learned from this book. Read so many books about King, or we've seen so many documentaries, but we really just have started just to scratch the surface. in terms of telling these stories about what really happened and people's radical visions of freedom. And there were several points that I wanted to raise. I thought it was a beautiful narrative that just magically told a history of, you know, King's evolution that disrupted the idea, as you stated, that he became more radical and turned his attention to economics in those latter years. And so what you see in the book is that from the very beginning, King always had a critique of capitalism. And that was, you know, he was nurtured by a family and his wife, who also shared these radical ideas. And so that was something that I really appreciated. But he also brings in a history of both civil rights and labor, but also you get a sense of what's happening in the world. And I'm like, how does he do this in 200 pages, you know? That you can, he definitely, as a reader, you get a sense of what is happening all over the world as King is taking his journey. The other thing that I loved about this book, too, is that it really humanizes King. There's a moment, I'm currently teaching a class on Black Lives Matter, the historical origins of Black Lives Matter, and Patrice Cullors, who's one of the founders of Black Lives Matter Network, there's a short documentary, in a sense, it's called Queer on the Front Lines. And she talks about how King has been presented to us as this impossible person, that young people have a hard time believing that they have anything to contribute because they're not King, who's this impossible subject, you know, that he was perfect, that he was so, courageous, and that he had this brilliant gift that, you know, a lot of young people don't see themselves as King and then feel like they don't have something to contribute. And so it really underscores this text that he was a human being. He was extraordinary for sure, but he was a part of a larger movement of ordinary people. And so I really appreciated that too. There's one thing I wanted to mention that you didn't mention in the presentation here about the social gospel of the Black Church.
Yeah, thank you.
And I wondered if you would comment on that, because it reminded me of this tradition within the Black Church, whereas Christianity informs Black people's resistance to racial injustice and also economic oppression. So I thought about David Walker's appeal from the 1930s, where he talks about Christianity compels us to kill our slave masters because human bondage is a sin, you know? And even so with Nat Turner, who was religious, John Brown, the white abolitionist who helped to plan a slave insurrection, felt deeply that Christianity compels us to fight against human bondage, which is a sin. Now, of course, they weren't nonviolent. Mm-hmm. It was impossible in that context to be nonviolent in the same kind of way. Mm-hmm. But I wondered if you could just give us a sense of what you learned from the social gospel of Black churches that informed King's radical vision for freedom.
Yeah. Cornel West says it best. I've got some quotes from him in the book. That the Black church was the way that people survived in the Deep South in the aftermath of slavery. And there always was this social gospel, even under slavery, about what does Christianity mean. And they interpreted it themselves, not the way the masters interpreted it, which was, you know, that you should obey your masters and be beaten with many stripes, but rather that you are a human being and you matter. And the church became the way to raise kids who didn't have parents anymore because of slavery breaking up their families. It became the way for people to study and learn to read. It became like a social institution. And King's father, Daddy King, came out of that whole framework in the Deep South, in the rural areas, and brought it into the city in Atlanta and studied the parts of the Bible that talk about poor shall inherit the earth, and part of Luke when it says that your duty is to serve the poor. And so that was the framework of the King family all along. So it's not a big leap to go from that into graduate studies and read some of the theologians that King read and link together the social gospel, which was a critique of capitalism in the late 19th century and then became a broader critique in the Black South. But King took it to its logical conclusion, which a lot of people didn't do, because he was such a political person.
And I think what's interesting is that a lot of times in our studies, we tend to think of, sometimes, I mean, I guess it depends on who you're talking to, that the church was conservative.
Yes.
And that ministers are conservative.
Yeah.
And so you offer a different interpretation through the social gospel that I thought was really intriguing and compelling. The other contribution of the book is really just tracing how working people contributed to the civil rights movement, including unions. And a lot of times the narrative is conflicted in that we associate the labor movement with the work class whites, and that there's this conflict because of racist ideologies, but you recover a lot of that history to show how labor unions did contribute a great deal to civil rights activism. And also that African Americans were trade union leaders too, you know, the women as well. And so I really appreciated that. And so when you said you reframe King, I want to suggest that you reclaim him. That you reclaim King and you reclaim this history, because the history I really believe has been intentionally distorted, that it has been intentionally whitewashed or watered down so that we don't remember those radical moments that can help inform our struggles today. And so the focus on Memphis, I think, was so critically important to me as well, because I often teach about Mississippi as an alternative narrative of how we think about the civil rights movement, that you had these ordinary people like Fannie Lou Hamer and Amzi Moore and others who weren't like King, but were so strong and so courageous, you know? And we don't study the parallel institutions like the Freedom Schools and the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, because then that troubles what we think about in terms of the Democratic Party, you know?
Yeah,
and so I
this
insertion of Memphis too as another critical site to study, and that totally, you know, changes our perception of what the value of the civil rights movement, or it even changes our perception of its failures or limitations, because, you know. And I have to tell you, I had the opportunity to visit the National Civil Rights Movement Museum at the Lorraine Motel. And I tell you, you all have to go. I've been telling my partner that we have to make another trip. He doesn't want to go in the summertime, however, because it's hot.
It's terrible in the summer. Don't go
but
in the summer.
This museum is the best, and I've seen a lot of museums throughout the South. I visited almost all of the civil rights ones, and the one in D.C. is nice, but since I went to the one in Memphis, I couldn't like the one in D.C. I'm telling you, this one in Memphis is so, and it starts from slavery. Actually, it probably even starts in Africa, and it hits everything. Now I want to go back to see how the interpretation might deal with the economic struggle, but it's a beautiful telling of the black freedom struggle from slavery to the present. And when I walked into that parking lot, and I was just rushing, I was at a conference, like, oh, let me go see the Lorraine Motel. And I walked into that parking lot, and I wasn't even expecting, I was overcome with grief. To the point where I started screaming, and had to muffle myself, and had to walk away from the balcony. It was harrowing to be there.
Yeah.
And to see his room. But what they've done is they built this museum underground somehow, so you still get the feeling of the original motel, but this museum is incredible, and they have two buildings across the way. So it is really worth taking your family and taking a trip there. And also, then you get to see the Stax Museum in terms of, you know, experiencing the music history in Memphis. The other question I wanted
to
ask
you. That's
so great. So please, you have to do that. It's a beautiful museum. The other question that I had a point of contention with the two points in the book that I kind of just want to open it up for to think about further. Because towards the end of the book, you help us, you know, immediately after King, we get to the point where King is assassinated. He then talks about how one of the priorities of Coretta Scott King, who is amazing, like I didn't know that she just immediately stepped in the mold of being a leader. She wasn't just a mother, you know, and a wife, that she was a leader and thinker and activist, but that she also pushed having a holiday, this holiday. And you state that the holiday reminds us of the best of who we are as Americans and make us proud. And I wondered if that is even a romanticization of what the holiday has done. After reading the text, it made me feel like that holiday was a dirty trick, even though that wasn't her intention, but it has lionized him in a way that his legacy is just totally unrecognizable that it focuses on this colorblind democracy rather than this economic justice. Mm-hmm. And so, and then I thought I was always blaming the right wing, because we see how the right has co-opted King and say, you know, they all, that one line from, you know, the content of that, the character, color of the skin, that's all they remember. Not the bad check, mm-hmm. that we came here to get our money, that we've been given a bad check. But maybe, you know, then I'm realizing the liberals have distorted this legacy too, and that it's been convenient to do so. And so I wondered mm-hmm. about the holiday, and wondered if how are you thinking about the holiday in relation to this question that you raised in terms of how should we remember King? Mm-hmm.
Well, I was privileged last year to go. We have a big event in Tacoma every year on the holiday, and a lot of school kids come, and a lot of, the thing that makes it difficult is you also get all the politicians, and you get the advertising from companies, and everybody wants to be in the same room and bask in the idea of a colorblind society. Isn't this great? Because we're all here today doing this. And not this year, but the year before, the this great, or maybe it was this year, but anyway, this really great teacher from Lincoln High School came, and he told the whole story. And usually, I've been disappointed. You go and people kind of give you a pablum. You know, they don't give you the real thing that would help you to see what, to clear your way through American propaganda and TV and everything. And this guy just laid it all out. And so I think that's, it's an opportunity, you know, and it's a battle. And of course, that's why I'm writing these kind of books.
Yeah.
It's a battle to try to get people to stop misremembering mm-hmm. King. But what was your term instead? Reclaiming.
Yeah, reclaim him, yeah.
King. And I think that's what we need to do. And that's a important policy and mm-hmm. campaign that we should be doing.
I'm seeing more of that on social media, actually. So people have been, you know, circulating memes or just short five things you didn't know about King or the radical side of King. So people seem to be using social media as an alternative to, like, our history books or, you know, the meager information we get in our education about the civil rights movement.
I saw, just as a side, I was in Columbia, Missouri at University of Missouri right after Ferguson happened and the police shooting. And the black students on the football team shut the school, or they were going to shut down the homecoming game and unless the president resigned, because he was so racially insensitive. And sure enough, he resigned. I mean, within a few days, they did that. And they were wearing slogans, injustice anywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Now, where did that come from, you know? That's a letter from the Birmingham jail, you know? So I think it's getting through sometimes. And when we start seeing slogans like, we should no longer be profit-centered, but centered on people, then we'll be getting through even more.
You know, just today in class, I showed images of the protests after Ferguson, and a lot of them were also carrying signs saying, I am a man.
Yeah.
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 And so they were drawing from that as well. There's also, I just wondered, the book, you emphasize that there's this movement gives us hope out of despair. And I felt like that really is something that we need in this moment, mm-hmm. as we might feel despair, mm-hmm. and that we can learn from it, like, even as horrible as it seems, people during that era still had the courage to stand up and fight. And so I wondered, at this critical moment, especially around the issues of economic injustice, Black Lives Matter has tried to have a conversation around state violence as a way to maybe bring attention to economic injustice and how that is intertwined with you know, the state violence people may experience with police surveillance and police violence. But I wondered how, in this moment, do we get buy-in from white working class, poor whites, mm-hmm. who have seemingly found inspiration in someone like Donald Trump?
Yeah, yeah.
You know? And not just the poor whites, but even the wealthy whites.
Especially the wealthy.
And so, I felt like there was some hope in this book, but then thinking about our political landscape mm-hmm. and how ideologies of white supremacy and anti-blackness are still so much in play that it, you know, people are still voting against their interests or aligning themselves in ways that are against their economic interests.
Yeah, yeah.
How do we get past that?
I don't know. That's the big question. You know, I gave this talk in Tacoma, and the same question came up, and I was in the same spot, like, I don't know. One of the discouraging things in writing the book was I kept also coming up against the white backlash, which was based a lot in the working class. It was, you know, the Republican Party is not led by the working class, right? So let's not confuse that. But in all the campaigns that King was involved with labor, they always had this problem of, like, trying to bring the white working class into the civil rights framework. And it's very difficult. And then, you know, somebody like Trump comes along and says some of the things that seem like they make sense, but actually they don't. And his framework is all wrong. So that is one of the biggest challenges, and I can't say that I do know the answer to that one.
What I really thought that was great about how you reminded us of King is that he was saying a lot of things that Black Lives Matter say today in terms of emphasizing that none of us are free until Black people are free, or when Black people are free, we're all free. And that's almost verbatim what, you know, so it's like, oh, we can go back to King saying this, that our destiny is tied to each other, you know? And so you have to, you know, support struggles against racism, because that ultimately is, you know, our struggles against economic injustice that impacts everyone, you know? I have a gazillion questions here and comments, and so at this point, I would like to open it up so that you all have an opportunity too to raise some questions. Do we have to have people come to the mic?
Yeah, so if you have questions, we'd love to have the audience join the conversation at this point. Please do come up to the microphone. And we have about 15 minutes to get through audience questions. Thanks.
I'd also like to invite the young people who've come today, too. Like, I'm putting my students on the spot. That's good.
So I'm interested in the craziness. I mean, really, Donald Trump has power because of the media and money. Real people know that hurting other people is wrong. We get caught up in fear. Okay, so that's the issue. And the question is, do you feel that perhaps American medicine, not surgery, but medicine, and how American medicine defines craziness is an important item here? This is my thing, so I'll shut up because I talk too much. But what's beautiful about Baldwin is he describes the craziness. And it is a craziness. People are wonderful. But in this fear-based world, we can't even talk to one another. So that's the question. Can we think that perhaps a part of this is the medical industrial complex?
Well, I just read, I think it was yesterday, that the pharmaceutical industry spent, I think, $121 million last year lobbying Congress, and that one of the drugs just went up 700% in its price. And any attempt to interfere with that, is stopped in its tracks. It's a lot like the NRA running policy, you know, in Congress, by corruption, essentially. And I think the medical system is incredibly corrupt. And not to say that doctors are corrupt or that nurses are corrupt, but the structure of it shouldn't be based on profit, you know? It's really wrong.
I think what she's getting to is a little something different, maybe. I'm wondering too, well, let me say this. I'm wondering if there has been a move in Black Studies scholarship, and maybe it's not just Black Studies, to explain white pathologies. That you have a long legacy of explaining Black pathologies, that black, or even what Black people have suffered as a result of slavery. But we don't feel comfortable having conversations about what did slavery do to white people? What did lynching do to white people? What did that kind of violence and these ideologies of white supremacy, or these mythologies of white supremacy, do to white people who were also repressed and silenced and fearful of even speaking out, even when they knew it was wrong? And that does produce a craziness. And so I smile when you say that, because there is a quote in the book, and this is why you gotta read the book. There is a quote in the book where Martin Luther King talks about white people being crazy. Like, you gotta be crazy to think that black people and white people shouldn't be in a swimming pool together. You know, that's crazy talk. Now, that's not what he said verbatim. But he does mention something about how segregation, racial injustice, even economic injustice, that is crazy, you know? And so I thought, so there's so many quotables beyond this content of our character that I got from the book that I never heard before. And so he actually makes some kind of commentary on that. Thank you for raising that. Come on, y'all. Yes. And if you have some questions, you can just come up front.
Hello. So I'm taking this African American literature class, and we're learning about Malcolm X, who was often seen as the more radical of the two. And I was wondering, of course he was radical in a very different sense, but I was wondering if you guys maybe thought that there maybe was just room for one radical in the civil rights movement, and kind of Malcolm X kind of took that place instead of Dr. Martin Luther King.
You know, I think that's a great question. I often think about teaching the movement in a way that tries not to have this radical break between civil rights and black power. You know, that we often distort black power too as the angry turn of civil rights. And I try to pull out the value of black power in terms of it focused on a human rights framework rather than a civil rights framework, that there's an international component to that. It's an anti-colonial component to that. And I realized after reading this book that I'm also doing it wrong, because from the very beginning, there's evidence that Martin Luther King is advocating a human rights frame, that this doesn't just come up with black power, and that he's paying attention to anti-colonial struggles and making those links. What I also like, what was useful, was this intervention of how we think about nonviolence. And so that we may have misinterpreted, maybe even people during that time period, as passive resistance. And so Reverend Lawson reminds us that it's not about being passive, but that it was a radical strategy to not only get international attention to the violence that was happening in the United States, but that it also connects these cruelty systems, as you state, that you see the interrelated relationships between these systems. And it makes me think of Angela Davis. This is precisely what her recent book, Freedom is a Constant Struggle, is about, where she defines intersectionality not in terms of identity, but the intersectional relationship between, you know, imperialism and neoliberalism and capitalism, you know? So that reminded me of that. And I just wonder, there's tension obviously during that time period, but it's also how we remember this moment. And always in black studies, for some reason in black history, it always has to be this or that. Which side are you on? Is it Du Bois or Booker T. Washington? Is it Du Bois and Marcus Garvey? Du Bois had problems with everybody. Was it Martin Luther King or Malcolm X? And then all these people get eliminated from the conversation. Like Ida B. Wells, Anna Julia Cooper, they were all a part of that conversation with Booker T. Washington and Du Bois. And so we have this tendency to set it up as it's just these two debates between two men. And that's also a distortion of the history. But for whatever reason, that makes people comfortable in terms of how you frame it. But what this book does is also reclaim King as a radical and push us to think and rethink what we mean by radical. Because as wonderful as Malcolm X was for some of us in his rhetoric, he was also very much a spokesperson. He wasn't always out in the streets. You know, he gave a lot of speeches until the final years of his life where he started to travel internationally and organize. But that came late for him, you know. And so I think it really forces us to reconsider what we mean by radical. And that's definitely an intervention of the book.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I couldn't say anything better than that.
Did you all see I Am Not Your Negro? That documentary about James Baldwin?
Yeah.
And so part of what I think the documentary was trying to do is to, you know, it says that, it, you know, Baldwin realized that Martin Luther King, Medgar Evers, Malcolm X, even though we try to place them as being at odds, you know, Malcolm on this side, that they were actually very similar, you know.
I had a question regarding, you talked about John Brown and the uprising, which was violent, but it was concerning the times. I wonder if you guys could, if you both could comment on the Antifa movement, mm-hmm. especially in Charlottesville. I remember that Cornel West said that had it not been for the people who were involved with the Antifa movement, had they not been in front of the faith people, the white supremacists who were coming in, who really wanted to physically hurt them, that it was the Antifa people who basically saved their lives. And I'm just wondering if you want to touch on that, because it's very controversial, the whole Antifa. Thank you.
Well, you know, there's a place for self-defense. Even Dr. King, when his house was bombed in Montgomery, and he dispersed the crowd. People were came, you know, to fight. They were really angry. They had guns, and he told them to go home. And he explained it as part of Christian love, but there was a real pragmatic basis to it, you know. So his framework is always about Christian love, but nonviolence is a pragmatic method. And James Lawson explains this very well. That it's really, you have to think about, if you use self-defense, what will be the result in a given situation. And it's one thing if you're under attack and you can actually do something to stop violence. But the confusion in the 60s partly was the idea that somehow you could have a violent revolution. And James Lawson was explaining always that if you thought about how many guns the U.S. government has, if you thought about how many guns the right wing has, there's no way that you're going to have a violent revolution. That's one thing, but then the self-defense thing is another thing, you know, and it's not the same thing. And so King, I quote him in the book, he says that everybody accepts that people have the right to self-defense. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about movements in the streets and what's the common discipline that we have. And this is where King and Malcolm X really conflicted, because Malcolm didn't have that conception. But I think he was getting there. He was starting to understand the pragmatism of nonviolence, even though he said, I could never do that, you know, but maybe he could if he was in the same situation. So I think the thing with Cornel West, you know, somebody did save those people from getting really terribly injured. And, you know, that is self-defense. But the idea of fighting it out in the streets with these Nazis would be a really bad idea. Mm-hmm. So very limited kind of thing is what I would say. You know, you can define as self-defense. But fighting it out in the streets, forget about it, you know.
There's also new scholarship that challenges our ideas about nonviolence. So you do mention Charles Cobb's book, mm-hmm. That Nonviolent Stuff Will Get You Killed. Mm-hmm. Okay. And also We Will Shoot Back by Akinyele Umoja, where he traces the movement for self-defense in Mississippi. And so it wasn't possible for SNCC to go into Mississippi without those families having guns in their homes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And what he found in his research is that when black families and communities protected their homes from night riders and the Klan or mobs that were coming in, I mean, they had intricate setups, you know, booby traps and things, and would shoot back. They didn't come back to those neighborhoods to harass them. And so it was absolutely necessary. They couldn't go into the South, you know, and tell black people to be nonviolent in their homes when there was a real threat to their lives every night, that people would sleep on their, take turns sleeping on the roof to see if white people were coming to attack them. And so the Dinkins for defense, there were times where they would have their guns in view during a nonviolent protest. So they're not a part of the protest, but I'm sure some of those people who were committed to nonviolent struggle may have been relieved that there were some people on the outskirts with guns who might, you know, bullies don't want you to fight back. They think that you're not going to fight back. And so these people weren't trying to lose people when they were attacking black folks. And so Mississippi, We Will Shoot Back is a really interesting history that traces that, not even contention. I think he kind of argues that they both had to coexist. But right, you don't take these guns out into a march. The nonviolent strategy was a part of your direct action tactic. But self-defense was absolutely necessary at home. I lived in Charlottesville right before I moved here. And I lived there previously for 10 years and then went back for a postdoctoral fellowship. So I had just left before that incident happened. And what's so violent about that, which is kind of similar in Seattle, is that that moment happened and now we say, oh, these outsiders came in. But this is a place that worships Thomas Jefferson, you know? And so it's just like, this is a place where, you know, we will be called the N-word just walking down the street. And it got to the point where it didn't even bother me anymore that you see Confederate flags. This stuff was happening years before. It's the wealthiest. They kept saying that Charlottesville was the best place to live in the country. Well, best for whom? When you have this extraordinary, you know, economic disparity in this city. It's pretty disgusting, you know? And so then coming here, it's interesting after that, the first time I really even heard about the Antifa is here where they were doing Black Friday protest, and there was some concern that these people break the windows and all this and that, and isn't that horrible because we would just want to light the tree, and you know. And so those things, people have to protect their bodies, and you know, self-defense, I think, is necessary.
Well, maybe we should take one more and then finish with a song.
So I know that there were a bunch of issues and movements that King spoke on and contributed to that weren't necessarily focused on race, but did stem from this belief in universal human rights, such as like the nuclear disarmament movement that he was educated on by his wife. And I was wondering, how do we reframe these movements that aren't necessarily centered on race, but this belief in universal human rights, in a way that encourages like marginalized people and not like no offense but older white people to only participate? And how do we like reframe the conversation around these movements?
Well, I don't know what the right language is these days. When I was involved in the freedom struggles in the South and in Michigan too, and this has been my framework all my life, really, is that I think of the freedom struggle as my struggle. So I never have thought about it as, oh, that's for black people, and this is something different. In terms of the anti-war movement, anti-nuclear, anything, I've never seen it that way. I've always thought we're all in this together, and fighting racism is very much in my interest. And if you don't do it, if you're not proactive doing it, then it's going to catch you. You know, you're going to. And I've discovered this working in the movement in the South, in Louisville and Memphis and other communities, that you can't be lackadaisical about it and we're all in this together and think that that's really how things are. You have to be proactive and always alert. And so sometimes movements fail because they're not. You know, they're just thinking, oh, we're just together, what's the problem? There's always a problem with race in the United States. And so I think it's really important for people's consciousness, and I try to teach this with students, like, this is your struggle. This is not somebody else's struggle. This is your struggle. And here's why, you know, and that's why we study history, and so we get the whole picture. And going back to that thing about the white working class, I think this is the problem, you know, trying to get people to understand that. And it's not impossible. So I interviewed people in the who were organizers in the 1930s and 40s and 50s in the Deep South, white workers who were organizing white workers into coalition with black workers in unions in places you wouldn't think that could ever happen. And they told me, like Ed McCrae, Red Davis, other people, you can do it. It can happen, you know. You just have to really deal with the questions that working class people are dealing with. You can't just do it from the outside. So with anti-nuclear anything, you have to get everybody all in, and you have to really always be aware that racism, sexism, homophobia, all these things are issues that will come up, and you have to, you know, be alert and build unity. Mm-hmm. And I think of it as building unity. And so, you know, it requires criticism and stuff too, but yeah.
And I think in recent conversations, people have been troubling the notion of allyship by focusing more on solidarity for the same reason you just mentioned, that you're not an ally as in you're going to help someone with this struggle, that this struggle is about you too, that this is about your interests. Even in the case of police violence, that disproportionately has been impacting black people, but if we allow the police to, you know, abuse their powers, that puts all of us in danger. We're going to be in a police state. There are white people who are killed by the police, and so those things affect them too. And so this is about, you know, as you just stated, this is, and it makes me think of John Brown, like the spirit of John Brown is here, because he explained why he wanted to, you know, collect arms for these slaves, and said that slavery was an affront to his humanity, that he felt it deeply, that it dehumanized white people too and dehumanized him. And so it wasn't that he was helping these black people, he was helping himself in trying to overthrow slavery. And I think that I don't mind the old white people being out there and doing some work. You know, we all have to do our work, and somebody has to show up. And it's not on just black people or people of color to have these conversations. So even if it's just white people in the room, that's an important space for them to do some work, you know. But I would be more interested in hearing from the young people in terms of what their ideas are as far as what would, you know, what does the language need to be, or what are the ways in which you kind of can bring people together. There's always room for innovative ideas, and I think you all have the creativity and the innovation and the energy to do that, and shouldn't feel like you have to reach back in history to replicate it exactly. You reach back in history to learn, you know, about challenges and to think about what worked and what didn't work. But we can use some fresh ideas too, you know, and so if you have those fresh ideas, you should feel confident enough to try them out, you know. So thank you for raising that. One thing I wanted to say, I don't know if you had a last comment, but one thing that I found really moving about the text too is one quote from King, where he says that change is not only possible, it is inevitable. You know, change is not only possible, but it's inevitable. And I think that's something that we have to really keep, you know, our mind stayed on that too. You know? Mm-hmm.
Stayed on freedom.
Thank you.
Thank you. So Latasha and I will be out there, and I'll be signing some books when we get done here, but let's finish with a little rousing music.
Resurrected when the Kensington Globe Experience, and I'll be out there and say hello to everybody.